I'm Troy Hanna, President and CEO of the Spartanburg County Foundation. Since the foundation began working remotely, we've been eager to find ways to remain connected with our donors, fund holders, nonprofits, and community members while we remain completely operational. We understand this is a difficult and alarming time for Spartanburg, our state, our country, and our world. It is imperative that we do our part as your community foundation and continue to guide you to resources to meet the critical needs of our community and to closely monitor and communicate investment portfolio impacts. The foundation's community leadership team has hosted two virtual Nonprofit Connect sessions that were attended to capacity, discussing how to build resilience in times of unexpected change and how to develop grant writing skills. We have another Nonprofit Connect session coming up in May. Chamley Lasciuto, Principal Consultant for Heightened Development, will be teaching us how to lower stress while mastering change when we are given no choice but to adapt. One participant in our Grant Writing Nonprofit Connect session said that she had received life-changing information that will forever impact how she applies for grants. Reserve your spot today as sessions are filling up quickly. There is more information on how to register on our Facebook page. In February, the Spartanburg County Foundation established a Spartanburg County Disaster Relief Fund focused on supporting the nonprofit organizations working firsthand with community members dealing with the aftermath of any range of disasters that affect Spartanburg County. The fund was created in response to the EF1 tornado that left thousands without power and many Spartanburg families with damaged or destroyed homes. And now we are here, facing another storm together that has left many in need of immediate relief and understandably with concern for the future. The crucial philanthropic work of the Spartanburg County Foundation endures during this COVID-19 crisis. Grants for March and April from the foundation and our donors totaled $2.4 million being deployed back into Spartanburg County. This included five grants totaling $12,000 in immediate relief funds from the Spartanburg County Disaster Relief Fund. This fund continues to respond to immediate needs through a responsive rolling grant cycle. Thank you to all who have given to the fund and enabled immediate relief work to take place. I would like to now introduce Jeff Croteau, Managing Principal with Prime Buchholz & Associates. Jeff and his firm have been working with the Spartanburg County Foundation Finance Team, the Investment Advisory Committee, and the trustees of the foundation to closely monitor our investment portfolio during this crisis. Our value of stewardship at the foundation becomes imperative in managing your charitable community assets in a time of extreme volatility. Our portfolio has been designed to weather such storms, which you will hear about in just a moment. And it is in times like these when we understand the importance of endowments. Jeff has taken the time to record an update for us all on the status of the foundation's investments in the current market environment. I would like to personally thank Jeff for taking the time to inform and educate all of us on how our funds are being impacted. As always, our foundation team is ready to serve you and is available via email as well as by phone. You will find ways to contact all team members through our website, spcf.org. We wish you and your families continued health and safety.
Hello, this is Jeff Croteau of Prime Buchholz, the investment advisor to the Spartanburg County Foundation. I'm here today to provide an investment summary of 2019 and the first quarter of 2020. We will cover the macroeconomic environment, investment returns by asset class, and key data that is relevant to the Spartanburg County Foundation portfolio. Over the next 10 to 12 minutes, we hope to provide a thoughtful and transparent overview that you will find both helpful and informative. The agenda today will include three sections. First, we will provide some information on the market environment. Second, we will review high-level information on the workings of the foundation as it relates to the investment portfolio. Third and final, we will offer some thoughts on the road ahead as we travel in this uncertain and challenging time. Let me now move to the market environment. What a change from 2019 to 2020. We finished last year, 2019, with excellent financial performance. We had high returns on most investments. We had record low unemployment. Corporate earnings were fantastic and at all-time highs. Low interest rates and ample liquidity throughout the financial markets. Stocks, bonds, real estate, everything performed well. The first quarter of 2020 brought forth a complete change in the economic conditions. Specifically, the global pandemic brought on by COVID-19 or the coronavirus spread from Asia through Europe and into the United States. That caused states and local municipalities to ask virtually everyone in the country to stay home, which essentially shuttered the economy. As a result of those two factors, we witnessed broad-based pain in equities, energy, bonds, really across the board. The equity market dropped by over 20%, and at one point in late March had exceeded 30% declines. Oil prices collapsed as a result of demand drying up. Airplanes sitting on runways, cars sitting in garages. The demand for energy simply has not seen a collapse like this in many, many years. Liquidity dried up across the bond market. Very little trading was taking place, and as a result, price discovery was very, very difficult. Volatility spiked to levels we hadn't seen in many, many years, and at sometimes it was even greater than the pain experienced in 2008 and 2009. And after all of that, we began to see jobless claims hit record levels week after week after week, as many industries saw their revenues drop to essentially zero. The pain was truly widespread, and the magnitude of the losses was extreme during this first quarter. One thing to look at as we plan ahead is to look at market yields, as shown on slide 4. This is an example of why we're not able to simply invest for current cash flow anymore in a foundation portfolio. The yield on a 10-year treasury bond dipped below 1%. The yield on the S&P 500 has consistently been below 3%, which means that in order to achieve the returns that we would expect and hope for in a diversified portfolio, one needs to seek capital appreciation through more growth-oriented investments like stocks and hedge funds and real estate. Yields at these levels have not been seen really ever in U.S. history. And you can see on this slide dating back to the late 70s and early 80s when these same measurements were 5 to 10 times higher than they are today. Slide 5 provides an indication of the level of volatility that we've witnessed recently. As we look at the last 20 years, this is now the third major financial crisis that we've experienced. In 2001 and 2, with corporate scandals and the tech bubble bursting, we saw volatility at these levels. We saw that again just 6 short years later in 2008 and 9, with firms like Bear Stearns and Lehman Brothers collapsing, and then the fallout of the residential real estate market being overlevered. Finally, we move to 2020, and with COVID-19 or the coronavirus spreading and causing very significant impacts on the economy, on the healthcare system, and the financial markets. We see volatility that spiked again. As you move to slide 6, we'll notice that one of the features of this economic crisis is the collapse in demand for traditional fuel, in this case, oil. Just 3 short months ago, the price of a barrel of oil was over $60, and there was plenty of demand and plenty of supply. It was a healthy and functioning market. But as demand has been severely impacted by the elimination or largely elimination of travel, whether that's ships, cars, or airplanes, the lack of demand and the difficulty in reducing supply quickly has caused prices to collapse. As shown on slide 6, you see prices that went from over $60 a barrel down to less than 20. And as we've learned, there was a technical glitch recently that sent prices actually negative for a very short time, truly unprecedented times. Central bank activity around the world trying to deal with this crisis has been swift. But as you'll notice on slide 7, we had finally started to move off of the record low levels of policy rates around the world that were in place since the financial crisis. You'll notice that the Fed had finally begun to move interest rates up to what is considered a more healthy level, and that has been completely reversed in just 6 short weeks at the end of the first quarter. As I shift gears and move to slide 8, and we begin to look at actual performance of the various asset classes instead of market economic data, you'll notice on slide 8 that we first focused on this painful first quarter of 2020. As I mentioned earlier, stock returns were worse than down 20% during the first quarter, as shown in the blue and green bars on the left. The U.S. market was down almost 21, and international stocks down 23. But that was certainly not the only place to lose a lot of money during the first quarter. Hedge funds were generally down. Real estate was certainly down, and there were lots of other categories that aren't shown here that also suffered financial losses. And these losses actually are not as bad as they were a week prior to this print. Before the end of the quarter, the stock market had dropped by more than 30%. But one thing that we did see during this crisis is that the traditionally reliable places to hold value, things such as treasury bonds, or even global bonds, or TIPS, which are a form of treasury bond here in the United States, were able to generate positive returns during this first quarter. This is often known as a flight to quality, as investors flee from risky assets and the losses they're incurring into those that provide them some comfort and safety, despite the anemic forward-looking returns for those asset classes. Now, this chart stands in stark contrast to the one you see on slide 9, which is a recap of the same asset classes and their performance during the calendar year 2019. As was mentioned earlier, conditions in 2019 couldn't have been better, with low unemployment, record earnings, and strong stock performance. As shown here, the U.S. market was up over 30%. International markets were up over 20%. Real estate earned very competitive returns north of 20%. And even the lower risk asset classes like hedge funds and fixed income had strong mid to high single digit returns. Finally, on the right side of page 9, you'll notice that inflation last year came in at 2.3%, finally at a level that many consider more healthy than what we've experienced in the 10 years since the financial crisis. This, of course, was reversed again in the first quarter of 2020. Let's now begin section 2 of our agenda, where we move from the market environment and we begin to focus our comments on the Spartanburg County Foundation portfolio. Shown here is a history dating back to the late 90s of the assets managed by Prime Buchholz with the Spartanburg County Foundation. There are, of course, other assets at the foundation, but this represents the lion's share of the assets. And with some exceptions, such as 2001 and 2 and 2008, and certainly in 2020, the portfolio has experienced strong and consistent growth over more than two decades, going from a level that was less than $45 million in the late 1990s to over $190 million at the end of 2019, which had been a fantastic year. The first quarter brought pain, as was covered earlier, by the markets and by portfolio managers, and we saw that level drop to $164 million. Disappointing, of course, but fortunately, these are not permanently impaired assets. And we've already witnessed, as we publish this webinar today, the portfolio has recovered to some extent with a very strong month of April. So we're encouraged that the direction is back in the up and to the right trajectory. As I move to page 11, this provides information on the asset allocation of the portfolio. It's important to remember that we try to manage in a disciplined fashion with long-term strategic targets. Generally, we're close to these targets, except during periods of transition. The portfolio today is in the midst of a one-year gradual shift to reduce hedge funds, also known as flexible capital, in favor of more traditional domestic equity and bonds. This move will improve liquidity, lower fees, and should deliver a comparable risk profile to the prior policy. As you'll see, we are very close to our policy targets in most categories, with the exception being the cash in transit, as shown on the right-hand side, is being redeployed into domestic equity, and there will be one more move in the next quarter from flexible capital into the broad global equity markets, which will allow the yellow bars, as shown on slide 11, to line up almost perfectly with the blue bars. In the interim period, we try to stay as close as possible and certainly within the policy guidelines. And this was a decision that was recommended by the committee and approved by the board last year and has been carefully executed by senior management and Prime Buchholz over the last three quarters. Moving to slide 12, we'll take a look at performance. Certainly, this is a direction that we don't like to see, but given the depth of declines in the stock market during the first quarter, it's no surprise that the County Foundation's portfolio also dropped in value by 13.9%. Keep in mind, this was during a period when the stock market dropped by nearly 21%. We also underperformed compared to the policy index for this quarter because we have active risk in the portfolio, and sometimes active risk works against you. Over the long term, in fact, over all periods beyond 5 years, this portfolio has both performed in a positive fashion and above the policy targets over all of those periods. And in fact, dating back 30 years since inception with Prime Buchholz, the portfolio has exceeded its policy target and generated a return of 7.6%, which is sufficient to cover the rate of inflation, plus a normal spending, plus some cushion to help for a rainy day. For a bit more granular look at that 7.6% annualized return since inception, I'll move to slide 13. And we'll notice that the portfolio has delivered that level of return with a comparable risk profile to the policy index over a very long period of time. And the primary contributors to that 7.6% return, as shown below, are the domestic equity market, which represents the largest category in the portfolio over that time frame, international equities, flexible capital, fixed income, and real assets have all served to diversify the domestic equity risk. The weakest area in this portfolio happens to be the area that we've only invested in since 2008, real assets, and that's an area designed to hedge against inflation. And as we know, there has been essentially no inflation for the last 12 years until 2019, but that was quickly reversed in the first quarter of 2020. So we're disappointed with the performance of real assets, and that's something that the investment committee and the board are constantly reassessing with Prime Buchholz's help. But as you look up above, you'll notice again strong performance from each asset class compared to its benchmark, where domestic equity, international equity, flexible capital, and fixed income have all posted positive returns and better returns than their respective indexes. This is very, very important because it highlights the benefit of careful and diligent manager selection throughout the portfolio. As I move to slide 14, we provide this because it allows you to see the annual returns by asset class in the portfolio. So while we're disappointed with the 13.9% loss in the first quarter of 2020, one only needs to move over one column to be reminded that just 1 year ago in 2019, the portfolio gained 17.4% in just 12 months and had exceptional performance in every category with positive returns throughout the equity, flexible capital, fixed income, and real asset components of the portfolio. However, in order to achieve the returns that have been earned by the Spartanburg County Foundation over the long term, we must accept a level of risk that will occasionally put us in negative territory for a given year. You'll notice on this slide 14, negative performance or losses took place in 2011, 2015, 2018, and certainly the start of 2020, which is just 3 months in. But that's offset by years such as 2012, 13, 17, and 19, where there have been double-digit gains earned. This type of volatility is necessary to find the types of top-line performance that we'd like to see in order to meet the spending goals, the operational goals, and the growth goals of the foundation. Moving to slide 15, we'll cover another topic that's related to the risk in the portfolio that we believe is incredibly important. Moving beyond the variability of returns, we also want to look at the liquidity of the investments. And specifically, for an investor like the Spartanburg County Foundation, we'd like to look at a combination of assets that can be accessed immediately. And in this example, approximately two-thirds of the portfolio is invested in things that can be accessed on a daily basis. This provides excellent flexibility to the board and management and Prime Buchholz, and it also provides great protection if there are unexpected needs, either in the community or at the organization. At the same time, with a portfolio that we expect to exist in perpetuity, we want to make sure that we take advantage of investment opportunities that may be less liquid. And in this example, the final third of the portfolio is spread between investments that may only trade once a month or once a quarter. And while these are not quite as liquid as those assets that can be accessed on a daily basis, they've proven to be very valuable either in terms of generating additional return or lowering the risk level of the portfolio. Finally, let's move to the third item on the agenda, which is a look ahead. As shown on slide 16, you'll see that the board and the investment committee and Prime Buchholz seeks to remain patient and disciplined through these difficult times. We're constantly looking for the best managers to capitalize on new and unexpected opportunities. This is particularly relevant today as we see the world changing and certainly the economic conditions and financial conditions for individual companies and in fact entire industries are different than they were 3 and 6 months ago. And our goal is to find managers that can best take advantage of these opportunities. We have to rebalance the portfolio to ensure a consistent risk level. As equities have dropped in value at times, we tend to be buyers. And as fixed income or equities outperform their expectations, we tend to be sellers. This discipline over time has contributed to our strong performance, and it's a key tenet of our investment philosophy. And then finally, as we covered, needing to maintain liquidity in the portfolio to deal with any unexpected cash needs or changes to the market is critical. So that's something that we all focus on a regular basis. We hope to find healthier days ahead, both from a national health perspective and a financial perspective. We're encouraged by the movement in the second quarter, as we've now moved from April into May, and we've seen exceptional market performance coming off the bottom that we saw in March of 2020. So we are encouraged, and we continue to be very, very diligent, and again, look for brighter days ahead. Thank you.